Good afternoon, friends. I am Saket Bansal. I train people on project management. I am a PMP trainer. I also train people on agile methodology. And I run a company named Eyes and Brace Consultancy Private Limited. And today we are talking about contact type. Contact type is a topic which forms the base for procurement management knowledge area. The procurement management knowledge area is one of the knowledge area which has processes in all the process group excluding initiation. So the procurement management knowledge area is kind of an essential and a very important topic for PMP aspirants. So today we will discuss the depth of contact type, and it will form a basis for your further future studies related to procurement management knowledge area. Before we begin, I would like to know the audience. And in order to know the audience, I have a small poll, and this will help all of us to know or set the tone for our webinar. So let me initiate the poll and then we start our webinar. So I want to know how many of you are planning to give PMP exam very soon. And this is the poll. So please share what are you planning to do for your PMP exam. Are you planning to do it before 31st July because a new version is coming, or you are already certified, or you are not thinking of giving an PMP exam in the near future? Okay, so let me close the poll and here are the results. So you can see that a majority of our audience are planning to give a PMP exam before 31st July, which is a good thing. And like that will help us also in focusing our discussion, because we have some serious PMP students with us. Okay, let us proceed. So this is an agenda for the session. We will talk about what is contract type, how does it impact us, what are the characteristics, why should we worry about the various contract types, and what kind of PMP exam questions can come on a topic like contact type. During this session, I will take two Q&A breaks in between, and then we will have a final third Q&A break at the end. So while I'm going through my presentation, if you get any questions, just type it in your question box and I will look at them during the Q&A breaks. So when we talk about contract is an instrument which formalizes the relationship between buyer and seller. So since we have many people, attendees, who are planning to do a PMP exam very soon, when we are talking about procurement, we should think like a buyer. When we are thinking of scope, integration, time management, cost management, we usually think ourselves as a seller, because we think that we are providing some service to someone. But when we are into a procurement management knowledge area, we need to think like, in order to deliver our project objective, we want to procure something from some other vendor. So this is the only knowledge area where the project manager need to think like a buyer. In rest of the knowledge areas, we always have a customer, we always have a stakeholders to whom we always keep communicating and keep satisfying. But in a procurement management knowledge area, we are the customer, you are the customer, and you are the buyer, and you have a seller, and the contract. Contract helps you to define the relationship between you and the vendor, you and the seller. So usually a contract is defines a relationship, and it's a legally enforceable. So contract has a legal binding. Since it's a legally enforceable instrument, we cannot have contract for illegal activities. So the contracts are usually made for legal activities. The project contract should be formally written. So it's not necessary to have all the contracts formally written. We can have verbal contract also. In some countries, verbal contract is also acceptable in a court of law. But for projects, it is always recommended to have formally written contract. So in other part of life, you may have verbal contracts, but for project, you should have formally written contract. And this particular contract should explicitly describe goods, services, role and responsibility, payment terms, which are related to this particular business relationship. So it's a legal document. It's legally enforceable. It's a formal document, and this specifies the details of goods and services which the buyer is buying and the seller is providing. Now, we have three types of contracts which we would be talking about. These are like base contract types. Which particular contract type is applicable for your project is driven by primarily two factors. The factor one is what type of goods or service you are buying or selling. For example, if you are buying a consulting service, you may not be able to have a defined fixed price. But for a ready-made goods, so if you are buying something, if you are buying a book, or if you are buying a finished product which you can feel and visualize, you will always have a fixed price with that particular product. Now, the other dimension which drives the contract type is level of uncertainty. How uncertain your scope of work is. The more uncertainty will take you towards the project contract types where there is a flexibility in changing the scope and changing the requirement. The more certain requirement you have, you will move towards the contract which can be defined upfront and which can be estimated upfront. Now, when we talk about contract types, especially when we talk about PMP exam, these are the three base contract types. Now, you may see various variants of these base contract type, but these are the three base atoms of our various contracts. Fixed price contract, which talks about having a fixed price and scope upfront. Cost reimbursable, it's the type of contract where the buyer pays the cost involved in the service or goods plus some fee. So whatever the seller is spending in order to perform the job is getting reimbursed. Time and material, it's a type of contract where the seller provides time or a professional service with some amount of material on a given rate. So these are the three base type contract types. Now let us look at fixed price. So fixed price is a type of a contract where you have a good, where you have a product, and you know there is a tag on it. You can just look at the tag and this is the only money you have to pay for that particular good. Usually you can have a fixed price contract when you have fixed scope, when you have a defined scope, when you know what you want to buy. If you don't know what you want to buy, you cannot estimate or nobody can sell you at a defined cost. Now, as a seller, in case of a fixed price contract, the seller can only get into a fixed price agreement when he has some mechanism of estimating the amount of work, time, material, cost needed in order for delivering that particular good or service. If the seller cannot estimate the amount of money required to deliver the service accurately, getting into a fixed price contract would be a risky decision for the seller. But if he can estimate it well, then it becomes just a one of his service. So if you have a finished product and you want to say that these many products need to be supplied at my factory, there is no problem in going for a fixed price contract because you know this is you have a finished product and this much cost it takes to transport product A from one location to another location. Now, some example for the fixed price contracts are usually the construction project. For example, if you want to buy a flat, you usually have a fixed price contract. You have a defined EMI which will run for X number of months, and at the end of that X months you get the flat. Even if there is a change in the price of cement or there is a change in the price of steel, you don't get affected. So usually the construction projects are fixed price projects. If you are buying some packaged software, for example, if you are buying an antivirus or if you are buying Windows, you know that there is a fixed price. Sometimes even the packaged software with some level of customization can also be bought at a fixed price, because the seller can visualize the need well and can estimate what all will go into this particular delivery. Holiday packages. So there are packages which talks about, like, you get 3-night stay at this particular location, this many amount of food buffets, etc., etc. So they tell you the scope of work and they tell you the price. So it becomes a fixed price. You don't have to pay anything extra, and you will get only things which are defined in that particular package. So these are the few examples of fixed priced contracts. Now, there are pros and cons. From a buyer point of view, it's easier to manage, because, for example, if you are going for a holiday, you know that this is the only amount of money I have to spend. You can easily budget it. Now, from a seller point of view, if he is sure about the expense required or the cost of delivering that particular service, it is easier for him also to budget. He can also budget it, that this is the amount of money I am getting, and if this I would be spending, this would be my margin. So things are predictable upfront. Now, the problems with it is that the holiday package is relatively a simple example, but if you want to take a fixed price contract for a complex requirement, you need to know the statement of work well. So all your requirements should be communicated well in advance before you get into the contract. And if, as a buyer, I'm talking about as a buyer, if there is a change in, there is a decrease in the labor cost or material cost, you don't get any benefit out of it. So for example, if you have bought a flat at a fixed price rate, and if there is a reduction in the cement prices, you don't get any benefit out of it. Now, from a seller point of view, and you can relate both the things when I talk about seller need to enforce strict cost control. So if you have bought a holiday package and if you want to add one more meal into it, seller will say no. So he has to ensure that there is a strict cost control, there is a strict change management. And seller also need to control his own cost. So whatever money he is spending to deliver that holiday package, he need to ensure that all internal vendors, all the vendor to that particular providers follow the given cost budget. The change management becomes very stringent activity for the seller. And that is also, we should keep in mind that if we do not have clear, explicit statement of work, and if we go for a fixed price contract without having a clear, explicit statement of work, then seller can take an advantage of it. Seller will not change any specification, any requirement after getting into fixed price contract. It will pass through a change management process, and usually a lot of time the seller quotes higher price for the changes. Now, the risk from towards seller is that if market price changes, especially if it increases, seller has to bear the cost, because the buyer is only paying the fixed price. Now, there are three variants which are sometimes discussed in PMBOK or PMP material. The variant of fixed price contracts are firm fixed price, which is like traditionally used fixed price contract, fixed price with incentive fee, and fixed priced with economic price adjustment. Now, the firm fixed price is the general fixed price contract which we are familiar with. Whenever we think of a fixed price, we always think of a fixed price, a firm fixed price, where the money, the scope is agreed upfront, and after that, no change. So whatever happened, the good and service has to be delivered in the given cost budget. And there is no incentive for reducing, or the buyer will not provide any incentive to the seller for early delivery or or better delivery. So whatever scope I have set, you just need to deliver that. And if you change it, I will the buyer has to pay the cost. Seller will make a change request, and usually the change requests are priced higher than the original scope. A firm fixed incentive fee, firm fixed price with an incentive fee. So this is a small variant which gives some incentives to the seller on the basis of some performance targets. So in this type of a contract, we start with a firm fixed price, and then we identify some performance targets. The performance targets could be linked with the cost. The performance targets could be linked with the delivery time. When I say cost, it could be a lifetime cost, because the deal is only for the first phase of the cost, but there are subsequent maintenance and support costs involved for the project. So on the basis of a performance criteria, the buyer decides, the buyer and seller agrees to a bonus. So on the basis of their seller's performance in a contract, the seller get the incentive in this particular contract. The third variant of fixed price contract is fixed priced with economic price adjustment. So I was taking the example of a construction project. Now, if a construction company thinks that it is too risky to get into a fixed price contract, they may want to have some economic price adjustment clause in their contract. Now, usually these economic price adjustment clause are driven by standard index. They are driven by some indicators which are independent and which can be monitored by both the parties. For example, the seller may say that, okay, if there is change in exchange rate, since I am importing a lot of things for this construction, if the exchange rate changes more than 10%, your cost will increase by X percent. So in a economic price adjustment, we have an indicator, and this indicator becomes part of our contract. If there is a change in that particular indicator, upward or downward, the cost of the project get revised. So there is a fixed price, but there is a clause that if the economic conditions are changing, and these are the parameters which will reflect the change in the economic condition, then the price of the contract can change. So for example, if there is a change the indicator could be inflation rate, could be a exchange rate, could be a price of crude oil, or could be a metal index, since the steel and copper are used to be sometime very volatile in a project. Now, this type of project, this type of contract is specifically important if we are getting into a long-term construction or a long-term projects where the execution of project is spreaded across many years, because projecting the economic condition for multiple years is a difficult task. So here we take our first Q&A break. So you can just post your questions. Okay, so the question for the poll is, in which type of contract seller will enforce a good type of change management process. So you look at the poll and let me look at the questions. Okay, so what about a fixed price with economic what is the difference between fixed price award fee and fixed price incentive fee? So I think the question is about award fee and incentive fee. So there are terms which we would be covering in primarily in a cost reimbursement project, but yes, in a fixed price also, there could be another variant of a fixed price. So the question was, what is the difference between fixed price award fee and fixed price incentive fee? Now, the award and incentive are used with fixed price and with cost reimbursement projects. Now, the difference between award and incentive is, awards are usually subjective criteria based. Like they don't have very defined performance criteria. When we're talking about incentives, they have a defined performance criteria which are quantifiable. The award fee type of contracts are subjective, which are qualitative. They are not quantifiable criteria. So if you have a subjective criteria, then the contract becomes fixed price with award fee. If you have objective criteria talking about specific performance numbers, then it becomes fixed price with incentive fee. Okay, could you please give an example of fixed firm fixed with incentive fee? Okay, now let us take an example. For example, you want to construct your own house, and you have given a contract of a fixed price contract to a contractor, and you have defined the scope, the layout is clear, the composition of material is clear, the detail of what kind of flooring, etc., etc., is used is all clear. So all the specification has been given, and on the basis of specification, on the basis of design, the contractor has given you a fixed price quote. Now, on the top of this fixed price quote, if you say that, okay, since I want to use this house soon because I am paying 50,000 rupees per month for my rent, and if you can deliver this house in 1 month advance, then I will give you an incentive of 1 lakh rupees or a 50,000 rupee. So that becomes firm fixed price with incentive fee. So you have given a fixed price money, but there is a criteria that if the person delivers soon, then you can pay the incentive to a given contractor or a seller. So let me look at the poll. We have few more questions. So time and material riskier for buyer and seller. So we will discuss this time and material thing. So just hold for a while. There was another question which is talking about that can I give an example of a fixed price with an award fee. So let us take the same example where we say that if you deliver the house and if we find the aesthetic of a house better than what we have visualized, we will pay you some award. That becomes fixed price with award fee. So you identify that look and feel, the layouting or the time of delivery. So if you deliver soon, then we will give you award. So the award amount of award may be disclosed, may not be disclosed, but the exact amount, exact criteria of those which can qualify for the award is not detailed in a contract. So we say that, okay, if you deliver soon, we will give you an award of 1 lakh rupees. Now this soon is may not be defined. A subjective, if you find that you have done a work better than our expectation, we will give an award of 1 lakh rupees. So this becomes firm fixed price with an award fee. Let me try to read this particular question. I may understand. In which type of fixed price contract does the seller have to take up the cost once it has crossed the agreed price? In a fixed price and a firm fixed price, as well as in a fixed price with incentive fee, in both the cases, seller, whenever we have a fixed price contract, seller has to take responsibility of delivery of a project without changing the cost. So whenever there is a fixed price contract, the cost is seen by default, until unless you have a special clause which gives some protection to the seller, which could be in a fixed price with economic price adjustment. But if you don't have those kind of clauses, if it's a fixed price contract, the seller has to bear up and down of the budgeted amount. Okay, let's see the poll results. Most of you agree that fixed price contract attracts the stringent change management process. You can keep typing your questions. I will take them in a next Q&A break. Now, the second type of contract which we are discussing today is cost reimbursement. Now, cost reimbursement is a type of contract where seller gets the actual expenses plus some fee. So this is a type of contract where seller says that whatever I would be spending, I would be sharing details with you. And on the basis of those detailed information, you need to reimburse my bills. So I am doing your job. Whatever I am spending, you need to reimburse it. And since I am doing your job, give me a fee on top of the reimbursement. So this is a type of contract which is called cost reimbursement contract, where seller keeps the inventory of all the actual expenses he is bearing. Now, what all type of costs are reimbursed? They need to be explicitly detailed out in a contract. Usually, in direct costs falls under this category. For the administrative and for the indirect cost, there is either a margin or that get covered in a fee or a percentage of actual cost. So, for example, if I says that I want to do a particular service for you, whatever money I would be spending in buying the direct element, you need to reimburse that plus the service charge or whatever service I am providing to you will cost you this much. Now, there could be a two type of cost reimbursement contract. Type one, where the seller gets a fixed fee. So, reimbursement of cost plus a fixed amount. The second cost reimbursable contract could be seller gets whatever he spent, he gets percentage on it. So, some example which can help you to relate well, like media buying on campaign. So, for example, if you want to run an ad campaign for promoting your product, you usually go with the cost reimbursable contract. So, media buying agency will plan the complete campaign for you, and whatever they are spending, you need to reimburse that. On the top of it, usually they charge percentage of whatever they are spending. So, whatever they spend in campaign, they will charge percentage of say 5% or 3% or 15% of the money which they are spending on buying and doing campaign as their fee. The second cost reimbursable contract you can visualize, easy to visualize, is car service. So if you go for your car service, whatever raw material get exchanged or whatever parts get replaced, you need to pay the cost of all these things. So that is why they keep calling you and confirming you that there is a problem in this particular component. Do you want to replace it? Since whatever they do, you need to pay a fee of, you need to pay the actual cost or a declared cost of that material. Plus, on top of it, you pay the service charge. A surgery, if you go for a surgery, if you are going through a particular process, now it is they always give you an estimate, but the real expense will be only known once you are done with the surgery, because many components may get added and deleted while you are performing the surgery. So their fee also, they may have a fixed operational theater fee plus whatever consumable they will consume during the surgery, you need to reimburse that. So these are like some of the examples which can help you to visualize what could be a cost reimbursable. So whatever I spend, I will ask you to give me, and plus I will charge for my services. Now, when do you cost reimbursable? When the scope is uncertain. So when you are going for a car service, you don't know what all you want to get done. If you are very clear that you only want to have washing, then you don't have to go in a cost reimbursable. You always go for a fixed price. You say, okay, wash my car and I am done with it. No scope change. But when you don't know what all need to be changed, only after diagnosis they can identify what all need to be replaced, then you need to go for cost reimbursable. Now, the cost reimbursable contract, the total cost is not known at the start of the project, because you always get an estimate. So whenever you get into a cost reimbursable type of contract, you always get an estimate. And the actual cost is not known till the time you are done with the work or till the time you are midway to the work. Now, since the actual cost is not known, it requires more administrative work. You need to closely monitor that, is it the right part you want to get? Is it really essential to replace this particular part? And from a buyer point of view, the administrative responsibility get increased, because you need to monitor what all seller is buying, why he is buying, is he following the right process, is he paying the right price, because you are the one who is getting affected. You are the one who is ultimately paying for the purchase which seller is doing. So from a buyer perspective, it will require more administrative work. Pro and cons. So from a buyer perspective, more flexibility for changing scope. So you can change the scope. There is no change request because you are paying. So for example, if you see that ad campaign, the TV campaign is not working, you say, okay, stop the TV campaign. Let us go for the newspaper campaign now. But if it's a fixed price, they will not stop. They will keep doing the ad campaign for the TV only. So it gives you a flexibility to change the scope. And from a seller point of view, you don't have to follow any rigorous change control system because you are not worried about the extra money the buyer, the project is taking because buyer is reimbursing it. Now, the disadvantage, the factors which we need to keep in mind while we get into a cost reimbursable projects are the seller has no incentive to control the cost. So as a buyer, you need to be very careful that seller is doing the right thing. Seller, your part may be not that defective, but seller may say, just replace it. So you need to be more careful that, okay, is it really needed? It's difficult to budget. It's difficult to budget the complete cost of the contract because things will change during the execution. And from buyer point of view, since seller is not following a rigorous change control system, you need to follow your own change control system and contract management system because you need to ensure your team is not changing the scope. So think of if the buyer has a team and seller also has a team which is serving to the buyer management should always keep eye on that their internal team is not changing the scope without a proper procedure. Because buyer is the one who is paying for it indirectly, so buyer need to enforce the internal change management process before, so that only the required changes, only the required things goes to the seller. So here the buyer has to become more aware, more conscious about the scope changes. From a seller perspective, they need to follow a highly transparent system, since they need to communicate what they are selling. What they are buying, why they are buying, what process they are following, so seller always get a confidence in them. It requires a good amount of communication and transparency from seller so that the buyer can understand the justification behind all the purchases. Now we do have a variance for cost reimbursable, some of which we have discussed while we are discussing in a fixed price contract. They are more or less same. Like we have a cost reimbursable with ceiling. So this is a type of contract where we want to have some ceiling. Say it says that, okay, this is a work, I will reimburse the cost, but it should not go beyond this. So a buyer try to put a cap on a project. So if you want to put a cap on a project, it's like cost reimbursable, but you have a ceiling price. Now the other type of cost reimbursable contract could be cost saving sharing. So it says that, okay, we will reimburse all the cost, but let us estimate the budget. And if we do the work in less than the budgeted estimate, we will share the saving. The third, fourth, and fifth are more frequently used variants, cost plus fixed fee. So this is a type of contract where you reimburse all the cost and you give a fixed fee. Like the car service I was talking about. Now the cost plus incentive fee, you reimburse the cost and you have objective criteria identify which can qualify for incentive. So the seller can claim the incentive if he meets those performance criteria. Cost plus award fee, we have a subjective criteria which can qualify for award if the seller perform the work on the basis of given subjective criteria. So same discussion which we had for a fixed price incentive and fixed price award fee is applicable for cost plus incentive fee and cost plus award fee as well. So let us take the Q questions and again a small poll. Okay, so there are few contract types which are which we have not discussed, but they are coming in Q&A. Okay, cost plus percentage, CPPC. So there is another type of cost reimbursement contract which are usually used for a media agency. In an example I used, which says that whatever you spend, you get 10% on it. Or easy to relate, you think of your portfolio manager. So usually portfolio manager says that whatever amount of buying they do for your shares, they get fee on as a percentage of it. So whatever buying they are doing on their behalf, their fee is percentage of it. Similarly, there are media contracts. Whenever they plan a campaign, they say that whatever purchase they will do for you on a percentage, like 15% or a 10% of that money will go in their pocket. Like when I talk about portfolio, like 1%, 2% of whatever they invest on your behalf will go to their pocket. So that is cost plus percentage. So cost reimbursement and percentage of fee. So we can use it when usually it is discouraged. We should not be using it much because it, in case of this type of contract, the seller has no incentive to control the cost. But in some cases, especially where the creative work is involved, these type of contracts are used. Usually these type of contracts are used where the intelligence and creative work is involved, where we trust the seller and we trust his intelligence or her intelligence for the purchase decisions. And that is how the media and the stock portfolio management type of contracts are used. So I am closing the poll and sharing the results. So it is, most of you agreed that it's a cost reimbursable project. Okay, so let's move forward. Time and material. If you are a software professional, this is your favorite contract because this is the most frequently used contract in a staff augmentation type of project. Now, here it's a mixture of cost reimbursement and fixed price. So we have a fixed price rate for the material or for the man, but the quantity is not known. For example, you say that my person will cost you X dollar per hour or per month, but how many hours do you need? I don't know. So you have a rate which is a fixed, you have a material rate, you have a time rate which is fixed, but the quantity of the material is not known. So you will be get billed on the basis of as much you consume. Now here, buyer is responsible for paying the labor. So if I am the buyer, for example, I am a software buyer, I am hiring few resources in a time and material contract, I have a fixed price for those resources. Now the seller is paying the salaries on his basis. Like there is no direct correlation between change in a salary and change in a billing rate. Salary may go up and down, but buyer get a consistent rate for the contract period. So this is a type of contract which is time and material. So you take time, you take material, and you have a price for your time, you have a price for the material, and you pay that. So usually the professional services like law firms, if you are hiring some consultant, these kind of contracts are based on time and material. So they will have a fixed hourly rate. And as many hours they spend in your project, they will charge you. The staff augmentation type of projects, for example, if you want to get 10 tester in your project, you just want 10 tester, you have a complete responsibility of managing it. You may go with a time and material contract where the seller is just giving you people on a fixed rate. Now you are responsible for getting work out of them. So this type of arrangement falls under time and material contract. Now the good part is it has more transparency because everything is visible to you. You have a visibility what all it will cost you, but again you don't have a complete project budget in your hand, but whatever the resources are doing, whatever the person is doing is visible to you. From seller point of view, you have nothing to worry about. You just have a rate which you are getting paid for, And irrespective of it is taking less time or more time, you don't have to worry. You will get your money. So they don't have to worry about change control also. Like if the buyer is changing the scope again and again, they are paying for it. They are paying on a fixed rate, but ultimately they are reimbursing, they are paying for it. Now, the problems with the time and material contract as a buyer is that you may have an insufficient or inefficient input. So when I say that I am giving you a 10 tester, all the 10 tester may not be at a expected skill level. You have a agreed rate, but the input, if the input skill is not as per the expectation, they may take more time. And since they are taking more time, as a buyer, you are the one who is paying for it. So you need to be very careful, and that is where, like in all staff augmentation project, the buyer usually conduct interview for the resources, because they want to be very clear that whatever they are taking inside in their project, they should be of desired quality. And they are also very conscious that if they find someone is not performing well, they would like to get the person replaced in a given time frame. So these kind of clauses are usually included in a time and material contract. Now, it is always difficult to estimate the budget upfront, because the complete project management responsibility is with the buyer. So if you are following a time and material contract, the complete project management responsibility is on buyer. The seller is just giving the resource. They are just providing the material, but ultimately the management of scope, management of time is done by the buyer. They need to manage the project's milestones very carefully. Now, somebody raised a question related to risk levels. Now, when we look at various perspective, if we are taking a fixed price contract, the seller is at high risk, because he's the one who has to estimate the price in advance. If there is an estimation error, he is the one who has to bear the differences. In case of cost reimbursement and time and material contract, the seller is at a low risk, because whatever happens, he may get less fee or more fee, but at least his costs are getting reimbursed. So the risk point of view, fixed price contracts are riskier for the sellers now, and the cost reimbursement and time and material projects are riskier for the buyers. So you may think that if I am a buyer, if I am a project manager and I am procuring, because in a procurement knowledge area, you are the buyer. So why should I go for cost reimbursement and time and material? Why should not I always take fixed price, because I have a low risk? So always remember that if you have a clear definition of scope, then you take a fixed price. But if you do not have a clear definition of scope, and in that case, if you take a fixed price contract, your risk would be higher, because the seller will take advantage of change control process. So it depends upon the uncertainty in requirement. If your requirement are uncertain, you cannot go into a fixed price contract. And if you go into a fixed price contract with an uncertain requirement, there is a high risk of cost overrun, even in the fixed price contract. So these are our communities. So you can join our Facebook page. We try to post various PMP related questions. We have just started our LinkedIn forum. So just this is an URL. These slides would be shared at our SlideShare account after a while. So you can get the URLs and do join us on our LinkedIn group, which we have recently started. And we try to support all of you to complete your certification journey by 31st July. We also have a YouTube channel, and this particular presentation will also get uploaded at our YouTube channel. And you can find few others PMP presentation and videos on our YouTube channel, and many more would be coming. So it's a good idea to subscribe to our YouTube channel. We have PMP and Agile videos in our channel. And these are my contact details in case you want to ask a specific query related to PMP certification or anything related to Agile certification or any project management training. Feel free contacting me. So this is our final Q&A break, and let me take the questions. Okay, there is a question which is coming, I think, again and again, which is the training provided by whom, by Unicom or iGenpeace Consultancy. See, this webinar is conducted by me. I am Saket, and I run a company named iGenpeace Consultancy. Unicom is our partner, so we do many things together. We have been conducting agile sessions and PMP sessions together for a while. So I think this clarifies your query. Any other question related to contract type or anything before we close this session? We still have 4-5 minutes which we can utilize in case we have any queries. Okay, there are few questions. Okay, there are various documents. So procurement has a various documents like request for quotation, request for proposal, request for quote, and now say some books are recommending that these type of documents are used in a type of contract. It's not always necessary, but yes, you can use that as a reference point. It's rare to get a procurement document related question in an exam, but if you have a good understanding of a procurement documents, like what is quote, what is proposal, what is teaming agreement. So these terms help you to visualize the story behind it. So it's good to learn about these all, request for quote, request for proposal, like details. But in general, in my understanding, request for quote usually we ask when we have a defined scope. And usually when we have a time and material, we ask for request for proposal. But again, we need to look at the detail, and not necessary. It can vary from organization to organization. Okay. Okay, so there is a request that can we take a session on cost and scope management. I will try to schedule it soon. And after the completion of training of a PMP process further. Now, there is a question related to a PMP certification. Now, in a PMP certification, there are two, there is a process, like some of you are still thinking about doing a PMP. So you need to take a 35 contact hour training, which you can take from a training provider, and you should be spending 35 hours in learning about PMP material. But the story starts after that. So 35 contact hour training is just a starting point. So find a provider who can give you a post training support, because else you end up spending good amount of time figuring out various details. Now the 35 contact hours training can be taken from your own organization if the organization is providing that training. The 35 contact hour training can also be taken from any legal training company where the course contents are aligned with PMP certification course contents. It's not necessary to be a PMI registered education provider. So you can also take from PMI registered education provider, but it is not mandatory. So since even I am not PMI registered education provider, and we have been providing PMP and PMI ACP training for a while, and many of our students are already certified, many of students have been through the audit. So legally the PMI has a written document which says that it's not necessary to take a training from registered education provider. Okay, how many questions in PMP exam do we get on formulas related to procurement management? See, hardly few. Like there are 2-3 type of numeric question which can come in procurement. One is make or buy decision, and the other is like point of total assumptions. Usually 2 or 3 questions you can see from procurement. In total you get 15 and maximum 20 questions on numerics, and majority of numeric questions are coming from cost and time. You can expect 2 to 3 max questions coming from procurement. Very rarely, like only few of the students have seen question related to point of total assumption, not many. Okay, another question, the training will be which version of the PMP? Currently it is modified to PMBOK 5. Now, in general, say I am not directly selling, or we don't have a direct schedule for PMP training. As of now, I am not publicizing it. But in general, we are thinking of we are recommending the students which are thinking of PMP now to go for PMBOK 5 only, because it would be difficult to get a dates for PMBOK 4 exam, and the time is also not sufficient. You just have 1 month left. So it's better to do a PMBOK 5 based training. But yes, there is minor difference between PMBOK 4 and PMBOK 5. Maximum 10% questions will change in PMBOK 5. So, but yeah, it's a psychological difference, but the project management remains the project management. The concepts, the idea, the theories are same, only the changes in input, output, and some organizations. Any other question? Okay, what is the best time to give a PMP exam after the training or collecting 35 PDUs? I usually recommend give it within 45 days. So it's like 4 to 6 weeks is good time. And it's if you have not started, if you have just starting the PMP journey, better to make some pre-training learning. Like you should spend some amount of time in reading a PMP related material before you attend for a training, and then you can get into the training, and should not spend more than 6 weeks. Like if you're focused, like if you can give that much attention and that much time, you should be doing it within 4 to 6 weeks. But it's recommended to read at least one book on project management before you attend a training. Okay, friends, so you can still remain in touch with me. You can join our communities which are related to PMP, and we have a community at LinkedIn, we have a community at Facebook, we have a Facebook page. You just get in touch in any of our community, and you can post your further queries there. I would try to answer them in the shortest possible time. Thanks for joining in. Have a good day.